That's a very inspirational opening by Birch. Because
I didn't write the song, but please.
Because we have a light that is blinding us. Get it? So, welcome to another episode of the One Corner Podcast. Once again, we have a special guest by the name of Gavin Goh. Am I right?
Yep.
Yeah, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you so much.
But once again, you're joined by only me, Warifani, and Birch, because Kevin and Chunyan once again have their own personal matters to attend to.
What personal matters? What do you have, guys?
And they have completely forgotten that...
time to fire them.
Yeah, we had to fire them. Leaving the minorities to do the jobs, basically.
That was Singapore.
Yeah, that's how Singapore was. Kevin has already defected already over to the other side.
Yeah, dude, Kevin.
So, Birch, you've known Gavin before us. So, do you want to give a brief introduction?
Okay, so me... Oh, I cannot tell where we work at. So, me and Gavin have worked together before. In the past, we work with youths. So, we call them delinquent youths, basically. So, those who...
Youths?
Youths. Hey, come in the podcast and you make fun of my pronunciation.
It's a running joke that Birch cannot pronounce words. Yeah, where he tried to pronounce
certain words, not all words.
Where he tried to pronounce Chris Hemsworth. He's like Chris Hemsworth.
I think it's time for me to exit.
Yeah, okay.
Anyway. Okay, so me and him, we work with delinquent youths. Okay, delinquent youths. Okay, those who enter the criminal justice system, based on whatever crime that they commit. Yeah, so we journey with them throughout until they successfully reintegrate back into society again.
Yeah. Do you want to continue telling us more, Gavin?
Yeah, what do you do,
Gavin? So, yeah, that was at a previous company where I used to work, what he mentioned. We work with teens in general. They're really at the adolescent stages. And currently at my new workplace, I am still working with this same group. However, they are one step down. Is where they haven't reached to the extent of committing many cases.
Right.
The youths that I work with now, they commit probably one or two petty crimes, like for example theft or getting in trouble with I would say, for example, getting into fights. Maybe it's their first fight, or maybe it's really their first time getting into trouble with the law. Ooh. And that's where they come onto this program where I work with them for a period. And we try to target some of this, their thinking, what made them decide to do some of these things. And I think another group of youths that I work with is where they have difficulties going to school. So they are mostly at home. Mm-hmm. There are reasons that have stopped them from going to school. So they have high absenteeism rates. And because of that, the school refers the cases to us. And that's where we work with some of these cases. Mm-hmm. Hopefully to, the bigger aim is to get them constructively engaged so that they return back to school. Yeah.
Absent? Mm-hmm. You like to absent class, right?
Hey, I had. Let me tell you, sister.
How did I become
a
sister?
A 99% attendance rate in school.
Okay, I obviously did not have 99%.
But as we all know, high attendance doesn't mean high grades. So even though I go to school, doesn't mean I listen.
What's the point then?
So don't go to school, kids. That's the point.
That's the end of the episode already.
That's the message I want to bring across. Is school is overrated. Do you mind telling us how you started, or what inspired you to start this career? Was there a certain figure or
a turning point
in your life?
I guess for me, I...
Turning point. This was meant to be, dude. Come on, man. Look at that. Turning point.
Today's imaginable sponsor is Subway.
Subway. Eat fresh.
Eat fresh. Yeah.
Yeah, great. I think for me, it's a very good question. I think for me, I've worked with younger youths growing up. I work in a student care. Yeah. So that's where I started out. And I saw some of these kids, they have behavioral issues along the way. They don't listen to the teacher, or they have difficulties. And from then onwards, I decided to go through this whole NS period and ask myself this question, what do I really want to do in the future? And I think during my NS, I was also a sergeant, so I had men under me.
Nice.
Yeah.
Two sergeants speaking each other.
Welcome, my sergeant friend.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Dominating the men, as
sorry,
we say.
I was cut above the rest. La.
Yeah, so I think as I was on my way, as I was a sergeant, I had to manage some of these men, and it came to me that maybe this could be something I could really do in the future to help some of these people through their own life. And also along the way, they had different issues. Obviously, one is like, I'm falling sick, I don't want to attend some of the...
Yeah, the choking warriors.
Why is like, he looking at me when you say choking? Yeah? Basket! What is this? Are you like implying something or...?
I never, I just turned only.
Yeah, just turned only one. Same thing, one. Yeah, don't worry about it. Turning point, turning point. So like the men that you encountered in National Service, they had
Muno intake. So they were some of them weren't really educated, we'll use the word la. Yeah. So they came in really fresh and very new, and they had a unique behavior, I would say. We had some men where I had met one that he didn't know how to shower.
Wow.
Yeah, so I had to teach him.
Was that the reason why he didn't know how to shower? Like,
no, the reason why he didn't know was because his mother was the one that was showering him.
Oh.
So at the age of 18, he doesn't know how to do it. So I had to show him. So I went to the toilet with him, with some of my sergeant friends. Like, so I said, show me how you shower. So he was like, he put the shampoo in his hand, he put it in his head, and then he pressed water and everything. I'm done.
Wow. I mean, technically,
some people do shower like
that.
Yeah,
no wonder they smell fantastic.
But he had also displayed habits like in the bunk where he had a very poor hygiene. So when every night when he had like phlegm and stroke, he would just spit it on the floor.
Ooh.
And next day spit, and he doesn't shower. He just
he just leaves it there, basically.
He just leaves it there. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. So let's Okay, so we are a counsellor, right, basically, right? So Gavin is a counsellor, okay? So we're going to talk about mental health. Mental health in Singapore especially, because it's a very, I would say, it's a taboo topic, I feel. So I think I want to ask you, like, among your clients that you work with, right? So what kind of issues do they come to you with? And usually what triggers it? Like, what causes their mental health to get worse?
Okay, I think it's a very good question that you ask. It's first getting to know what is mental health and what does it really mean to have mental illness. You know, there's this taboo word where people talk about mental illness. In the past, people think that this guy is crazy. Maybe he is involved in witchcraft or whatsoever. That's why he's like that. And actually, the definition of like mental health, if you go and Google it, it would say to be able to act emotionally, to be stable, to be able to manage yourself emotionally, physically, and even socially.
Right.
So these are certain norms that we have as humans. And I think the many cases that I take in, we see a variety, okay, where there are some that have depression, there are some that have anxiety issues, there are some that are able to manage their emotions, where they really, there's a lot of outbursts. So for example, something, and it can be anything, it can be small things like the mother, he tells the client, say, excuse me, please pick up a thing, then can get angry and shout, why you ask me to pick up? It can be any small thing. So actually some of these, if you realize, it goes back to what is going through their mind. Sometimes it's really the cognition, what they're thinking, that leads them to feel a certain way. Maybe he thinks that my mom is against me. Every time I say something, then I feel very angry.
Right.
And that the action is the outburst. Where I shout back or do some action. So these are, there's a variety, but I think in the use that we see nowadays, I think with technology being so rampant, that is definitely has also influenced them. They are so stuck to their phones or technology, and if you confiscate the phone, for example, they feel that, wow, that's it, like
my life is gone,
something like that.
But do you feel like, I mean, since he brought up technology, right, do you feel that social media has kind of like romanticized depression? Because like, okay, so we have one group of people who are officially diagnosed, right? So maybe your clients that come to you, there are certain group that is clinically already diagnosed, and then there are those where they exhibit symptoms but they're not diagnosed, right? But I also, I'm starting to see a trend of youths, young persons, they just like to listen to, like, let's say, sad music. They like to watch sad
Billie Eilish.
I mean,
I mean, I like Billie Eilish. Like,
okay, okay. So they listen to all this stuff, and then it kind of like brings the mood down. Mm. So it's like they're leading a completely okay life. Like everything is going fine. I mean, stable family background, stable income, good education, whatever or not. But it's just, is it really the social media that you consume that actually can also kind of make one feel very, I don't want to use the word depressed, because depressed is a clinically, it's a clinical term.
Mm. I mean, so depression is the clinical term, yes. But depression.
Look, who cannot pronounce words now?
The turntables.
Please put that and repeat that over and over again.
By the way, I am the editor. Depression. I have the power.
No, I want it in
there. So the depressed itself is a feeling, right? So I guess the common problem is that youths feel that when they're depressed, they're actually going through depression. Mm. But in actual fact, that's not the case,
yeah,
right?
Right. You're right. So I think along the lines where you're saying, where a person is depressed for a prolonged period, and they're really, really down. You know, when we're depressed, maybe I can do something. Some people like eat food, exercise, they feel better. Life goes on, and they're able to manage this depression. But there are some people, when they're so depressed that they are unable to manage it. That's where that's where if it's prolonged, maybe you can talk about 3, 4, 5 months in this state of like, I feel that everything's worthless. They'll say things like everything's worthless, there's no meaning in life, what's there to live, and this is really about that is a term where they could be clinically depressed. In order to be clinically depressed, you need to go and be diagnosed by a clinician. So you see a doctor, a psychologist, and go through the assessment and say, okay, I'm depressed. So sometimes I think youngsters nowadays, they may think, hey, I'm just depressed. I think I'm very sian, I'm very depressed. So it does not mean that they are really clinically depressed, but it's really about this definition is very important, especially when it comes to counseling. That's how we better understand and how we can support the youth or the client in this process.
How about we change the angle of it? In that sense, right, there are definitely some youths who feel like they are going through depression, but they have the worry that, oh, what if I'm actually not going through depression, and I am just like what my friends say, I'm just depressed, I'm just sad, I should just go and be happy, that kind of thing. But that's the danger of it, right? Like if you let that persist and prolong, it's gonna get worse. So like, what do you think about that kind of situation? And is there enough avenues in Singapore to help that out?
So I think this is a very good question that you have. I think on the flip side, where if this persists on, it can lead to more severe kind of thoughts that they might have, I think. And one of it is where they may have suicide tendencies or even self-harm tendencies, where some people, they hurt themselves. Be it using a fingernail or using instruments, and that's where they feel that this is a way to cope. Remember at the start we talked about coping, being mentally healthy. I think this is one way that they learn, and they can, on now social media, people can YouTube, they can teach you ways to like hurt yourself or even to...
That's a messed up, man.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like, I had one client that was like that. So I asked, where do you learn this? So she actually went to Google, what's the safest way to, the least painful way of killing yourself.
Right.
So it's, right. And there are answers. So I think for some people are thinking of the many, many ways, but that person, the client, still wasn't able to find the one that suits her the best. Yeah. So these are some very real cases that we have. And it's very real.
To go back to the romanticization of depression, there is a show on Netflix called 13 Reasons Why.
Oh yeah, we need to talk about that show.
Right.
Yes.
So I personally have not watched that show.
I've watched it, dude. That show is so...
So after you watch that show, right? Do you think that kind of show contributes to the kind of like romanticization of depression and suicide and stuff like that?
Okay.
I mean, you can give a backstory first.
Right. Okay. So 13 Reasons Why, basically, it's about this girl who was bullied. Right, so she was bullied. She was going through several traumatic experiences in school, and then what happens is that she started making tapes of each person that kind of like bullied her or did something to her. So then she released those tapes after she committed suicide. So I think it kind of like send the wrong message to the certain group of people, which I think is the youth lah. So they kind of interpreted it that, oh, if I'm going through, let's say, bullying in school and all that, the best way to
get back
then is to just take my own life lah, and do something similar. But I also think that the themes that they were promoting was also very triggering, because like certain scenes of like bullying, like if you are someone with similar background, like you went through similar things, similar traumatic experiences, I don't think you should watch it like alone, because you will it will bring back like memories, and then if you cannot like deal with it, then you just become, you just enter like in a very like low mood kind of like a stage lah. So I felt like Turning Reasons was really a, I don't even know why they have a season 2 and a season, do they have a season 3?
I think they're making a season 3.
They're making a season 3. Yeah, dude. So I think, I mean, yeah, like what Warwick said, right? Romanticizing suicide as like a, oh, it's a glorifying it like, in a way, it's kind of saying that, oh, it's okay to,
like they go out, they go out with a bang, basically.
Yeah, go out with a bang, exactly. Yeah. It's like, I just released my own take.
Like, do you come across like any like of your clients that mentioned to you that they were affected by kind of like shows or they watch that prompt them to do more harmful things?
Apart from the YouTube, that you mean, you say that they go and search ways to harm
them. I think many of them, I don't think it's what they watch on, like they purposely go and watch, but I think it's they have enough information out there for them. And I would say, to answer your question, I don't personally have a client that really is really affected by these shows. But I would say that it's many of them at these adolescent stages of life, it's really peer pressure that comes into play. And a lot of it, like he mentioned, bullying. And also sometimes they may have this thinking that it's also my teachers are against me. And everyone is kind of against me. And I think this is the only way to get out of it, to escape this whole, the term I will use is escape this whole turmoil or this whole pain that they're going through, because no one will understand me. So they actually avoid every single thing.
Right. I think I want to ask, like, so the clients that you know have mental health issues, let's say they open up to you and they share with you, right? They say, oh, I think I'm depressed or whatnot. Like, are they comfortable with sharing, with you sharing the same information with their parents, or they like, completely tell you, oh, please don't like tell my parents I'm feeling this way, or I'm having these thoughts, you know, suicidal thoughts and stuff like that?
I think many of them, when they come to us, I would say that they obviously won't want the parents to know that they have some of these thoughts, or like they are thinking because sometimes the triggering is the word to use, is where an incident that happened or a person that made them feel uncomfortable or angry. So some of the triggering factors are like the parents or even their friends.
Okay.
So coming to us, I think whenever we start the sessions, we will have to put a disclaimer out there that if anything were to happen to you or harm will be caused to yourself or people around you, we will need to alert the authorities, and we have to break the confidentiality. We cannot let it slide. So that is a very crucial thing that we as counselors or even social workers have to put it out there, so that they are aware. Because we have cases where, if let's say they will share with you where they were attacked or they were harmed. I had one recent case, he got beaten up by his own friends, and the father allowed it to happen. So that was a very confusing case. So after it came in, he went to the hospital, I went to see him, I realized whenever he goes home late or he doesn't follow the rules, his parents would physically hurt him.
I break, you know, curfews all the time, but
thank God you don't do anything to us.
So I guess, like, is it then, do you think that in that case, like, then what do you do to sort of mediate the problem between the child and the parents?
So it's a very good question. I think at this point in time, to be honest, as my role, I do have only limited things I can do. Because at the end of the day, now situation A is that he's in the hospital, so he's safe in a sense. There are doctors, there are nurses, and the parents need to go all the way there. So what we did is we raised a report to let the ministry know that this is serious, and we had to do an assessment to say how frequent were these hits that happened, at which part, what's the boy's account. And then after we raise it up, we write a report. So what happened is, I was preparing a report, the hospital already sent it in. So the hospital sent a report, and we raised it up to the ministry to let them know that this is a serious case.
Right.
And the Child Protection Services, basically, mm-hmm. is part of the ministry will come in and see, okay, what can they do? So some mm-hmm. cases, they'll try to mediate, they get the parents to go through counselling.
Mm-hmm.
The youth will be, if let's say he's comfortable, he can go home with them. If really mm-hmm. he's feel uncomfortable and father is still not cooperative, there is mm-hmm. a case where he might go to a home.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then the parents would still undergo the counselling, but at least the boy or the youth, or they are away from the parents.
Right, in a safe location.
Yeah,
yeah,
in a safe, we won't really disclose where, but they're in a safe location.
So I was reading this CNA article which mentions that, you know, I think in 2019, a total of 71 people aged 20 to 29, which is the rough age mm-hmm. that we are currently in, you know,
currently
taking
it's like
60
years.
Hey. The two of us, they mentioned that 71 people aged between 20 to 29, suicide is the leading cause of death for youths.
Mm-hmm.
And in the article themselves, they say that despite growing awareness in Singapore about mental health treatment, there's a kind of like a irony behind it, right? Like, if there is a growing amount of awareness, then why is the number still kind of high? Yeah.
And I think even though there's awareness, I think some people, in my experience, they don't take it seriously. They may mm-hmm. take some of the things that the youth are saying as passing remarks. You know, there are mm-hmm. cases where, I just kill myself. Then the parents will think, he's just joking. And even mm-hmm. though we warn, you can tell the parents, actually you should make sure there are safety measures, make sure that there's someone supervising him.
Yeah.
Say, no need lah. So back again, we are also, our hands are tied. Because mm-hmm. if the youth or like let's
Whoops.
Say the parents,
mm-hmm.
no worries, like if they feel that way,
mm-hmm.
there's so much we can do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one, I would say that could be one possibility, even though the awareness is there.
Mm-hmm.
And when more and more things, when in Singapore, living in a very stressful society and everything is very fast paced,
right.
more and more of these things are adding pressure to even, whether is it a youth to adult, some people really don't want to tell other people, even though they're aware, like I can go to this for help, I can go to that for help. They don't do it because they may feel that it's a shameful thing.
Right.
Some people, it's really, so it starts with also the cognition, going back to like mental health, it's a lot to do with their thinking. If they feel that seeing a counselor is a bit embarrassing, I'm telling someone that I don't know about my problems. When actually it could help you find new ways to cope with what you're thinking, what you're feeling. So this could be another reason, like they feel that it's shameful, or they feel that I can manage it. Maybe when I'm about to do it, then I need help, but by the time it's too late. Yeah.
So you mentioned shame, right? So actually recently I did a poll, very short.
Quick one before
okay.
we...
Oh, before we cut.
Yeah. Just a quick one.
Yeah.
Quick question, yeah.
For you. Oh, for me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Said, I'm mentioning it to you.
Oh, yes. Okay. Yeah. So do you ever get jaded in your job? Because now that you deal with this clientele base, you keep hearing their emotional outpourings. It can get very, it's an emotionally intensive job, right? Because you have to listen, empathize and all that. So do you ever feel like there was a time where you just could not empathize anymore because you are just like logically trying to problem solve the situation? So you kind of lose touch with your emotions kind of thing. When you are dealing with your clients lah, with, you know, mental health issues that can get quite overwhelming.
Yeah, and I think to answer your question, it would be, I won't really use the word jaded, but I think you have to be very aware of yourself. And I think going through this journey so far, I think there are points I ask myself, why am I doing this?
Mm-hmm.
Like, why am I here sitting with you, knowing that this is something that, as much as I can say, is the client's choice. And we need to be very clear that as a counsellor or social worker, there's really limited things we can do.
Right.
As much as we can talk about it. But to answer your question, I would say that half lah, not really, not like totally jaded.
Okay.
I would say that there was a point where I realized that maybe this is not for me. Because I think with other coupled reasons lah, you know, with the workload and with also different things, different life stages I'll put it.
Yeah.
I start to think, you know, is there something else better for me? You know, and I think I went through this whole stage of asking myself, why am I even doing this? So it's like half, I don't think totally, if totally I think I will kind of like, wow, I will need I need to take a break. Like I didn't take a break in essence, but I kind of ask myself questions, and that's where the next part is like supervision is important. Mm. You know, talking to people or having, taking care of your own mental being
first.
Your
yeah,
own
exactly.
Before you
before you can even work with somebody.
Right. Yeah. Dude, if he quit, he can join our podcast. We'll fire Kevin. We don't need Chun Yen. Both Kevin and Chun Yen. This is our new replacement, right? Sorry, Kevin. Chun Yen, we love you still.
The only disclaimer is that you don't get paid. I have to make it very, very clear.
Put it out there, the contrary.
Yeah, it is not a paid job. Yeah. So, Berch, before we recorded the episode, you put a poll onto your Insta story.
Correct.
In which, by the way, he didn't save. So there's no way I could have gotten the poll questions.
I did not. It didn't turn on my freaking archive, like, you know, saving. I don't know why. I mean, it's just
blame technology, huh? it's not the gadget, it's a user problem, am I right? So
okay, boomer.
Yeah, exactly. Dude, that's such an old joke, man. That's an old meme. So do you want to share with us like some of the stories that has been wiped on my voice?
So
have been shared like, to your
see after you make fun of me, yeah, your voice all going wrong today, right?
Ah, yes, yeah. Do you want to share like any of the responses?
Okay, can. So the question, so I put out very it's a public poll. Okay. Mm. So I put it on my Instagram story. I asked several questions. So I asked, the first question was, are they comfortable with sharing about their mental health with their close friends? So generally, there were more people who said yes, they're actually generally comfortable. But when it came to, when I asked the second question, which was, are you comfortable sharing with your parents? Then the response was skewed completely to no, right? So generally, adolescents, they are not comfortable sharing with their parents. Any idea why? Like, what's your take on it? Why is it such a... I mean, it's not, you mentioned the word shame, right? Maybe on their mental health is framed as a very embarrassing thing to say that, oh, I have a issue. Mm. I have a mental health issue and I need help, right? What other factors do you think could contribute to them not wanting to open up to their parents? Because, I mean, parents are important. Your family is like your basic foundation base, right? Mm. Yeah.
I would say that it's a very good question, and as I was thinking, that's what you were saying, it really boils down to also the family culture.
Right.
And sometimes, in an Asian context, if I would put it, some people are not as open to share with their parents. They are afraid that what their parents might do. I don't know why you saw this meme, where they said that these two boys were lost, they were lost in a forest.
So one
was...
Oh my gosh, it was trending. Yeah,
it's funny, because one guy says that, I need to find food or whatsoever. Then I scared my parents beat me or scold me.
When I finally find my way out.
So he's more afraid of the parents than getting help.
Right.
So it sets a stage, because I can relate to it, because I ask myself, you know, there are some things definitely I won't want my parents to know because I'm not too sure how they will take it, and I don't feel comfortable. I don't feel that they might even understand me. So that could be what, as an adolescent, it's just some of the things that they might be feeling, that as a peer, we are the same age, he could relate much better compared to my parents, who were just either, it really, like what I mentioned, it depends on the culture of the family. If there's a very open, let's talk about things, or the family is, you're already old enough already, you settle your own problem. You know, this kind of like the statements that you're actually telling, I don't want to hear what you're saying, you just settle yourself. So it sets the stage for them to say, hey, actually, you're on your own, you're responsible.
Right. So just to, I mean, earlier we did mention about shame. So the other question that I put up was, would you rather deal with it yourself? And a lot of people also again said yes. They would rather not talk about it. They would rather just like, you know, do it by themselves. Right, which kind of adds to what you say lah. Okay, so I did get two people to personally share their experiences. So I'm going to talk about these two just to close off lah. Okay?
Alright.
So the first one, actually what happened was, this was before attempted suicide was decriminalized in Singapore, which was 1st Jan 2020, right? So before that, this person attempted suicide, and he or she was cuffed, apprehended, put in a facility, right, until he or she had to prove to the doctors that, oh, I'm okay, I'm stable enough to be released back into society. So what's your thoughts? Is this how we should approach it? And I mean, now, even though it's decriminalized, is it enough? Is adequate help still being given out to these kind of cases?
Okay, so you have two questions there, like, with regards to what's my perspective on how the method that they use.
Yes.
And after this thing this whole decriminalized of this whole situation, mm-hmm. what are my thoughts on it? I think the first one, about how they apprehend, I think,
right.
It's hard for me to honestly comment, but I'll say that I won't totally agree with it,
mm-hmm.
but I think it's also to send a signal to them. I'm trying to think of the police point of view, that mm-hmm. actually it's to let them know that what they did was not right,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and they actually need help.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes it may come across that, wow, even like this, I don't know what's going through the person's mind at
yeah.
that point in time,
mm-hmm.
so it's very hard for me to comment, but I'll say
mm-hmm.
that it can be quite shameful because everyone sees you being cuffed for something
right.
that
exactly.
you are already struggling, you know,
with,
and that
yeah.
how more would that add on to whatever you're going through?
Exactly.
It could be
yeah.
another layer of hurt that you're going through,
mm-hmm.
another traumatic experience.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's quite shaming, and I think these are some things where it's part of this whole government policy and that layer. It's very hard for me to comment because I'm not at the tier of like
right.
why did they put this in or why did they even right. say that this is the way to go about it.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay, so the other experience, I think, so this person shared that the day after he or she attempted suicide, the friends and family pretended as if it didn't happen.
Mm.
So talk to this person as if it didn't happen.
Mm.
Do you think that's like an acceptable way to respond to someone who
okay.
is going to treat it as if, oh, it doesn't exist?
And is it like a additional factor to them committing the same thing again?
Mm. So it sounds like, from what I hear you share, it sounds a lot like avoidance.
Mm.
So the avoidance is where they try not to talk about it because they think that it's like the white elephant in the room. They know this happened.
Mm.
They don't want to kind of address it. However, it also boils down to what is their family and how do they treat some of these problems. Maybe growing up, this is how they've always handled. For
yeah.
example, let's say they see their father and mother quarreling. Okay, then the kids just don't talk about it.
Mm.
You know,
okay.
and they don't address any of this.
Learned behavior.
Growing up, yeah, it becomes a norm. Mm. Always the word a norm in the family.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very sad when I hear that actually that no one talks about it. And
right.
that even pulls you further away.
Yeah.
From your own family, I would say like,
yeah.
I would dare say that person might even feel, wow, even
right.
my own family may not even, they have this perception again back to their thinking that maybe my family also don't really bother about me lah.
Right.
So these strong statements that I use right, is really what drives their thinking. And the more I think like that, the more maybe his thinking is, I want to earn enough money, get out of my house.
Yeah, like run away from that. Environment.
Yes.
environment,
yes,
environment,
yeah,
yeah
right. correct. So, but then if he has that mentality, at least he's still staying strong,
mm-hmm.
and I am able to do this to get out of it. However, if it can go the other extreme, where, I'm so depressed, my parents don't care about me, I'm just going to hurt myself, or I'm going
right.
to do this again to get the attention that really I want y'all to regret. So that can be another thinking,
right?
That actually I want them to know what a grave mistake. You know, what
okay.
type of parents are. So there's a lot of these is beliefs like basically what drives that person, what is his thinking, and that leads them to feel a certain way. So this is based off the cognitive behavior therapy CBT,
right.
where our thoughts is linked to our way we feel, and that leads us to certain behaviors that
think, feel, act. The way you think, feel,
yeah,
act. Right.
Correct.
So I think to sum it up, I mean, I think the person's first contact with either institution or counselor is very important.
Yes.
For someone to respond to mental illness, because the same person shared with me that when he or she was attending counseling and going through a breaking point or meltdown, the counselor actually shouted at her.
Ah. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh fuck me, man. This is
we use this.
Yeah, we're just gonna keep it in. So there was some technical difficulties that suddenly cut off.
Chun
Yan,
where are you?
We can tell that we need a sponsor, number one. We need more budget.
And we need Chun Yan.
And we need Chun Yan back. If you remember what you said before this whole shit went down the fucking drain.
The last thing I said, right?
Yeah, the last thing
you
said.
So the last thing I said was
the last thing you said and the last words you wanna say is two different things.
Oh, sounds like I'm going to die or something. the last words I'm going to say. This is my last episode on this podcast. Okay. So the last thing I said was that the person that also shared about his or her experiences also mentioned that the counselor shouted at him or her when the person was having a breakdown. So I think it's very important what Gavin mentioned earlier on, that the counsellor also takes care of their own mental health first, right? Before they, before they even respond to their client. Because, I mean, the very fact that this person is finally seeking help, and then now he or she is traumatized by the experience, and they don't want to seek professional help anymore because of this incident.
It's very sad to hear that. Very sad.
Like, do you... Is that like a normal concern amongst like counselors? Like, even they cannot handle the pressure anymore.
I would say that if you're a younger counselor, you know, I do agree that if there's no proper guidance or supervision, the world will use it to kind of guide you through some of these things you're going through. And if you're left alone, you might feel this burnout and you might leave.
Right.
It can be very real as a newer counselor. You know, and when I first started out, it was very stressful because the cases that came in were a bit more high risk, which means that there's a chance where it could go like explode. It could explode
anytime. Yeah.
So what helped me to stay firm, obviously it was my faith was one, you know, my faith and to also get help, like what would you do in this situation?
Right.
Trying to understand and try not to put your own biasness. This is also another thing about counselors. We try not to put our own, for example, let's say between this couple, they want to divorce, so they ask you, should I divorce or not? Wow, ask me, I'm like, I'm not going to decide this for you. There's no way I'm going to decide. So I always ask the person back, like, what do you think about it? So some people,
throw it back.
Some people say, counselor, no answer, why?
What do you think?
Some things, it's very hard for me to comment. Yeah, like, at the end of the day, and I think going back to this question, how your friend experienced this, I'm very saddened because I would say that the counselor, maybe he could have an off day. You know, there are days where we're off, really we're off day.
Yeah, and I mean, we've all had it.
If it was me, I wouldn't see that. Not say I don't want to see, maybe on that day I'll reschedule. If I know, for example, maybe that day something happened, you need to kind of go through your own thing.
Processing.
Yeah, to process, you have to go through it and to really get yourself right. I think do it.
Right.
Sometimes we feel that the client's more important than us. So that is also a double-edged sword. That puts us into a position, then I am going to put the client above ourselves. Go home 8, 9 o'clock, still thinking about the client. Well, what should I do for the client? What should I... Cannot sleep like that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So I think that was a very informative episode. Definitely not something funny, because we're talking about a very...
serious topic. Like,
serious topic, you know, we have those episodes. But thank you so much for your insight. It was quite kind of like a... experience to know what it's like to be a counselor, the kind of issue that you face. You got anything you want to say?
Last words, I think mental health, I mean, it's a ticking time bomb if I were to say it. And I would say is that don't make it a white elephant. I think that's what you're trying to say, right? If you have mental health issues, please seek the help that you need. And I think especially for friends and family who have their children or their friends going through a mental illness, also please endure it with them. Because I think it's not easy to journey with them as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but here's to all you out there who are still going strong.
And with that, we will see you at the next episode, episode 26. Maybe another interview, maybe just one of us down here.
Another sponsor.
So, thank you so much. And thank you too, Gavin.
No worries, thank you for having me, guys.
Thank you too, Berch, for being here.
thank you too.
Yeah.
For being here.